Hello children, welcome to today's class. Hope all of you are safe at home. So before starting your class, I would like all of you to open your running notes and as usual make a list of important points. So coming to today's class, that is Heredity and Evolution part 9. So in the last class I have told you about the concept of evolution, and I have dealt with Darwin's theory of evolution, and I told you how long-legged animals survive compared to the short-legged animals, and apart from that I told you about important factors that is helpful in speciation. So in the last class we were speaking about geographical isolation, genetic drift and natural selection majorly. So today's class is a continuation of that class, and coming to today's concept, that is evolution. Here in today's class we are going to see evolution by stages. So today we are going to see more about the concepts involved in evolution. So here the major concept in evolution is, the first stage is evolution of eye. So you know that eye is a very important organ for animals. So animals, in the sense, it is not only four-legged animals, it is also involving humans. We without eye is worthless. So here eye is a very important organ, and the eye is complicated organ which cannot be generated by a single DNA change. So you must be very specific that each and every part in body, in a living organism body, is developed by the information present in the DNA. So here what I wanted to tell you is, eye is such a complicated organ in which it is not generated by a single DNA change. So the complex body organs of animals such as eyes have been created in stages over many generations. So the first basic eye is formed, which is also called as rudimentary eye. Please note down the spelling, rudimentary. So first of all, the rudimentary eye, that is the basic eye, okay, like that of a flat worm. So flat worm here is, in the next slide I'll be showing you the picture. So the flat worm here is the planaria. Okay, so this is the planaria, right? So this is a flat worm in which the basic eye is developed. So what is the function of this basic eye is, it is helpful in detecting light. It have some simple eye spots which can detect light. So the eyes of the flatworm are very simple, that are actually called eye spots which can detect light. So even these rudimentary eyes provide a survival advantage to flatworm. So starting from this basic design, more and more complex eyes were evolved in various organs, and the eye have been evolved in that way. So what I wanted to tell you is, actually it started in this planaria. This is the first organ in which the basic eye is developed, and after generations and generations the eye is it is improvised and it became more complicated. Okay, so as the generations passed on, and so afterwards this basic eye is, then it is changed into complex eye that we are seeing today even in animals and humans also. So most of the animals have eyes. So for example, insects, octopus and invertebrates all have eyes. So the structure of eyes in each of these organisms is different, which suggests that the difference in the structure of the eyes, it depicts the various evolutionary histories of various organisms. So like when I was talking about this planaria, it is developed, and the species that is which are more related to planaria gives the history of planaria. Okay, so see, for example, scientists study about human eye, okay, this gives an evolutionary origin of chimpanzee, right? Since we are chimpanzees are our ancestors, so the study of our eye gives you the evolutionary origin of chimpanzee, and they will say that yes, chimpanzees eyes were after generations and generations, they were more complicated and they were transformed into human eyes. So this is the evolutionary origin of humans. So same way, the structure of eye in each organism is different. So obviously, there will be different and separate evolutionary origins for different organisms. So here, the evolution of eye is an example of evolution by stages. So here, since we are talking about eye's evolution, so this is the first example of evolution by stages. So hope you got the concept, right? So this is the structure of planaria. Okay, so it is having rudimentary eyes, which is a basic eye. This is the basic eye. So this is having eye spots, which is helpful for the detection of light. So this is aquatic. Okay, this is an aquatic animal. So coming to the next stage, that is evolution of feathers. The first one is eye. So as you have seen in planaria, basic eye is after generations has become more complicated after many stages. So the next one is evolution of feathers. So this was discussed earlier also, when I was speaking about this Archaeopteryx, right? So there it is having both the features of reptiles as well as eyes, that is the birds. There I was speaking about feathers and all. So anyways, sometimes an evolutionary change produced in an organism for one purpose later on becomes more useful for an entirely different function. So when I was speaking about vestigial organs, right? I think you might have remembering the point. So vestigial organs, actually it is developed for one reason, and afterwards it is used for the other function. So similarly, so sometimes an evolutionary change produced in an organism for one purpose later on becomes useful for another entirely different function. So sometimes it happens. So I'll give you an example. Birds evolved feathers as a means of providing insulation of their bodies in cold weather, but later on these feathers became more useful for the purpose of flying. So actually birds developed feathers for providing insulation, that is to protect themselves from the cold weather. But later on what happened is these feathers became more useful for the purpose of flying. So even you have one more example, I'll continue with birds, then I'll go with the other examples. So what happened is even some dinosaurs had feathers. So here I was speaking about Archaeopteryx, right? So it is somewhat related to this concept. So even some dinosaurs had feathers, though they could not fly by using these feathers. Birds, however, adapted feathers for flying. The presence of feathers on birds tell us that the birds are very closely related to reptiles, because dinosaurs which had feathers were reptiles. So what he's telling is, dinosaurs, they belong to a category that is reptiles. So they have they have feathers like birds, but here the feathers are not used for flying. But in case of birds, the feathers are adapted in such a way that they can fly also apart from insulation. So here, like the study of feathers, the presence of feathers on birds tell us that birds are also closely related to reptiles, that is a dinosaur. Okay, so this is just to give you the evolutionary origin of organisms. That's it. So Archaeopteryx also, when they study the features of this Archaeopteryx, what they found is like it is possessing, it is a reptile as well as a bird, since it is having both the features. Okay, like reptile it is having sharp teeth and a long tail, and like bird it is having feathers. So, like when they studied the fossil of this Archaeopteryx also, they came to know that Archaeopteryx is like both a reptile and it is a bird, since, and they concluded that it is a connecting link. In the same way, dinosaurs also, they have both the features of birds and reptiles. So, this is about evolution of feathers. So, I will show you the picture. So, here you can see the birds having different patterns of wings, that is useful for providing heat as well as for flying also. Okay, so here in this left picture you can see this bird is not flying, just to show you a pictorial representation, that's it. So here feathers are providing it is provided as a means of insulation to their bodies. Okay, in cold weather. Here later on what happened is these wings were developed after many DNA changes, and it is also useful for flying. So initially, please note down that the feathers are there only for providing insulation, and after generations it is helpful in flying also. Okay, so no confusion, basic eyes, and gradually it is developed into more complicated eyes. And here also, initially it is developed for insulation, and later on it is developed for flying also. So this is about evolution of feathers. So the next one is evolution by artificial selection. So this is a very important concept. This concept you will be getting even in your plus one, plus two also. So that is the reason I am telling you. Anyways. So here in the evidence for evolution, we have studied that very dissimilar looking structures can evolve from a common ancestral body design also. Okay. So, but that was all guesswork about what happened in history long, long ago. So this is all just that is just a guesswork, but nobody knows the reasons actually. So, but here, I will give you an example from the present time, which will show that different looking organism can in fact be created from the basic design of the ancestor. So here I will give you a cool proof about the different looking organisms can be created from the same basic design of the ancestors. So coming to the wild cabbage. So you might be familiar with the wild cabbage, right? So wild cabbage plant is a very good example to prove that entirely different looking organisms can evolve from the same organism by the process called evolution. So that is, this will become more clear from this following discussion. And so the process, okay, and the process here is artificial selection. So we have seen about natural selection, and today we are going to see what is artificial selection. So artificial selection is not natural, so this is man-made. So here we are talking about farmers. So the farmers have been cultivating wild cabbage as a food plant for over 2000 years and have produced entirely different looking vegetables like cabbage, broccoli, cauliflower, kohlrabi and kale from it by the artificial selection. So you're understanding, I hope. So wild cabbage is the ancestor
which was developed almost 2000 years ago. And from this wild cabbage, I'll show you the picture, then you'll understand. So wild cabbage, it will be like long leaves, right? So you will have a cluster of long leaves, and from that farmers developed various different plants like cabbage, broccoli, cauliflower, kohlrabi and kale. You might have, like, you might be familiar with this cabbage, broccoli and cauliflower, but you people don't know, I think it is kohlrabi and kale. So all these almost the taste similar because they are from the same family. Okay, so you will understand how it is. Anyway, so what happened here is, so some farmers wanted to have, so wild cabbage has developed into various different forms. So the reasons are, so some farmers wanted to have very short distances between the leaves of wild cabbage and produce the common variety of cabbage. So actually I told you the wild cabbage is having long leaves, which is in cluster. So what they thought is, the farmers wanted to have very short distances between the leaves of the wild cabbage, and the common variety of that cabbage is cabbage. So in this way cabbages evolved. So they started cultivating, they modified the plant genetically and they came to know like what changes have brought the this cabbage. So in this way they made few changes in the wild cabbage, and finally they got the output like which they desire, like having short distances between the leaves of wild cabbage. They got a variety and that they named it as cabbage. And here this is not like just happening in one day, okay, one day or 2 days or something. It is it is not done even in overnight also. So it takes nearly like some years have been taken to convert this wild cabbage to like to develop a new hybrid. Okay, so that is how cabbage is like evolved. And the second one is, so like what they decided gradually is the form, like the farmers opted for arrested flower development. Okay, so the farmers wanted arrested flower development of wild cabbage. So broccoli was evolved. So what happened here, farmers, what they did is they wanted this cabbage as a flower. Okay, so that flower is also like, it should be like it should be in a compact way. Okay, I think you have seen broccoli, it will have, it is similar to cauliflower, but it is dark green in color. You can see the florets are compact. Okay, so they are arranged in such a way that they are arrested. So what the farmers did is they made the changes in cabbage. So after generations and generations, after working on it, so they finally they got the arrested flower that is developed from the wild cabbage, and that is how broccoli was evolved. So coming to the third concept, that is now I'm speaking about cauliflower. So when farmers wanted sterile flowers, okay, of a wild cabbage, so this is almost broccoli only. So here they wanted a somewhat a different kind of flower. That is, if you see broccoli, you will have almost compact florets. But in case of cauliflower, it will be like somewhat dispersed. Okay, they have sterile flowers of wild cabbage, and this was efforts were put in by farmers, and later on cauliflower was evolved. So this is how cauliflower was evolved. So coming to next, that is the fourth type. So when the farmers opted for the swollen parts of wild cabbage, this led to the evolution of another variety of cabbage called kohlrabi. So kohlrabi, like once I show you the pictures, you will understand. The kohlrabi is having actually swollen parts. Here the wild cabbage leaves are they are modified into swollen parts, and that this variety gave rise to kohlrabi. And finally the farmers wanted to grow large leaves of wild cabbage and ended up producing a leafy vegetable called kale. So what is it? This wild cabbage, I told you, like, it is having large leaves, right? And so this was further somewhat modified, okay, and that gave rise to kale, okay, which is also a variety of wild cabbage. So now this wild cabbage, which is the ancestor, and cabbage, broccoli, cauliflower, kohlrabi and kale are all its varieties. So which have been obtained from evolution, that is induced artificially by the farmers. Induced means that was introduced artificially by the farmers. So the ordinary cabbage, broccoli, cauliflower, kohlrabi and kale look so different from their ancestor wild cabbage that people had not all this look so different from their ancestor wild cabbage that if people had not seen it being done their own eyes, okay, so it is what you said, though they belong to, see, for example, like I give you, yeah. So here, we all human beings belong to same family, Homo sapiens. But though we belong to same family, like none of us look alike, right? So here, there is a variation between two persons, right? In the same way, though all these belong to same family, but all of them look different. Even though the taste and all are the same, but they look different from each other. So this is how you can say different structures can be evolved from a common ancestor. So this is just an example to tell you how different structures can be evolved from a common ancestor. So here you can see. So this is what is that term here? Yeah, this is the wild cabbage, right? This is broccoli, this is cabbage, and this is kohlrabi, okay? And so this is a normal ordinary cabbage, and here one picture is missing for you actually. So kale. Okay, so kale, which is almost similar to broccoli, it looks somewhat similar to broccoli, because since this wild cabbage is somewhat reduced and it is forming kale that is missing. So this is ordinary cabbage which we are using now, and this is wild cabbage which was used in previous generations, and this is kohlrabi, and this is broccoli you might have seen, and this is cauliflower. So these are the varieties that were developed from this single variety, that is the wild cabbage. So this is about evolution by stages, and in the next class we will be we'll be knowing more about how the life is originated, and apart from that I'll be talking about human evolution also. Okay, so here a worksheet is attached to this presentation itself, so you can solve the worksheet. You will not be getting that as a separate PDF file, right? So this is your worksheet. Please solve that in your science homework book. Okay, so see you in the next class.